We know there's a link between oral health and systemic health, but how does it actually happen?
Find out today on Medical History Mysteries.
That there are 57 systemic illnesses and counting that are exacerbated by oral inflammation. So my question for you and for us to discuss today is, how does it work? How does it happen? How do we see bleeding upon probing? And how does that travel to the body and cause problems elsewhere?
So Pam, it's amazing because that one word that comes up in all of our conversations, the one word that's been in the forefront of our minds all these years, that one word, inflammation, never really comes to mind when we start to talk about chronic systemic illnesses and the relationship with chronic oral disease. And that's because it's at this point, as the fields of medicine and dentistry integrate, we're starting to see that, how come we didn't see that coming? Like, we should have known that, because inflammation is inflammation, whether it starts in the mouth or whether it's a systemic inflammation in the body. We should have known that inflammation is just inflammation. Now, when you've got this chronic oral disease, infectious or not, let's just use periodontal disease as an example, okay? What is our mainstay of therapy? What do we always say? Our push is home care, right? It's go home, brush, floss, scrupulous oral hygiene, do everything we tell you to do. And that's wonderful. But really what's going on there is the oral membranes have become a little more porous than usual. There's more blood flow. As I like to say, people don't agree because it's not a real technical term, puffy gums, right? You're brushing and flossing, and you're forcing the inflammatory mediators that are formed as a result of this oral inflammatory disease into the oral tissues, where the blood supply now is greater as a result of the inflammation. And now off they go into the bloodstream. And sometimes we even force bacteria that are part of the sequelae of that oral disease into the bloodstream as well. So people say, well, how did I end up with P. gingivalis in my lungs? Or how did I end up with P. gingivalis in my, descending aortic aneurysm? Because we're pushing those bacteria and those inflammatory mediators into our bloodstream, and the bloodstream carries them everywhere, places where maybe we don't want. But the next piece of that is, what does that transfer of inflammatory mediator and or bacteria, what does that mean for the whole system? And so the current thought, and I could be wrong about this because, changes a lot, is that that generates a secondary system-wide inflammatory response. And that's one of the reasons we think people now get atherosclerosis, right? It's one of the reasons we think people get insulin resistance. And so you start, and among others, as you said, there's many more diseases that are correlated. And so now it starts to look like everything's interrelated, that it's all, at the end of the day, it's all inflammation. I mean, we focused for years on the triad. We said it was periodontal disease, cardiovascular disease, and diabetes. And then we added on another 50 some odd diseases. And then we realized, okay, it's not a triad. It's this one ribbon that runs through all of these diseases, and it's all about inflammation. Now, here's the problem. How do you treat inflammation? And some people think it's diet. Some people think it's lifestyle. Some people think it's, exercise. And some people think it's just, keeping your body from certain types of infections. So the hard part is figuring out what to do with the information now that we have it.
Well, so for the non-dental professionals that watch this, and thank you for doing that, it's not normal when you brush your teeth for your gums to bleed. Imagine touching your cheek or your hand or your arm. If you touched your arm and it would just spontaneously bleed, you would rush yourself off to the emergency room because that's not normal. Yet somehow society's made it okay for your gums to bleed. It's not okay. It's common, but it's not okay. And so if you're brushing and flossing and you notice that when you spit into the sink that there's some pink in there, that is a good reminder that you should go see your dental professional. And that is also why we start the conversation with the medical history, because we try to identify if you have, or if you're related to somebody that has, any of these illnesses that can be exacerbated by inflammation in your mouth. And on the flip side, there's systemic illnesses that can lead to more inflammation in your mouth. And so maybe it'll make traditional cleanings and scalings and different modes of therapy that we do in dentistry, you might not respond as well. And you might not respond as quickly as you would if the inflammation wasn't elsewhere in your body. So utilize your dental professional. And us as dental professionals, we should be working really hard to get patients to have zero bleeding points. You know, I feel like it was a goal of mine to say, you know, we want to reduce, or, you know, hopefully there's just a little bit of bleeding, or hopefully it's not crazy. But nowadays we've got technology out there. We have the ability to work with our patients to get them down to zero bleeding points. And it's possible. And I see it all the time.
Absolutely. You know, if you look back now, again, hindsight being 2020, think about all the times we've asked people about a positive family history for diseases. Do we ever ask them about a positive family history for periodontal disease, gingivitis? Like maybe, you know, mom, grandma, grandpa had cardiovascular disease and diabetes, but what was their oral health like? We never seem to get to that point of asking that question because we never thought that that could be related. And some people even say that poor oral health is something you do inherit. Maybe not necessarily environment, but maybe it is genetics. So it's all the stuff that's now coming up that we never really thought about before. But here's the key. What I tell all the patients I come in contact with is, you got to use white toothpaste, okay? Don't use colored gels, because that's going to mask some of the blood if there is any blood in there. If you're going to use mouthwashes, you know, a clear mouthwash, maybe, but I say rinse with water and spit first to see if there's any red. But I can't tell you how many people have said to me, yeah, but if I don't see red, I don't feel like I brushed hard enough. Okay, but that's not a marker for your, a check for extra effort, okay? So rinse with water first, you know, check to see if there's any blood. And when you see blood, because it's a tinge, some people say, well, it's not so bad. I was a little too aggressive and, you know, I'll be gentler next time. Not realizing that that's the sign, the marker, the earmark of something that can become much worse more quickly than you think. So yeah, I encourage, as I said, encourage, and you said, encourage your patients that no blood is good blood.
That's absolutely true. And again, we've got such a great opportunity to work with patients to get and keep them healthy for not only their teeth and their gums and their smile and their breath, but also for their overall health. So it's never been more important for us to prioritize this. And it's never been more important for patients to come and see us, because the greatest predictor for longevity and for optimum systemic health is, believe it or not, routine dental visits. So if you haven't seen your dentist in a while, give them a call. They're waiting for you.
Let's keep in mind one thing though, Pam, and I want to speak for the patients who are out there and who aren't part of dentistry, you know, people who are outside of our field. For them, this is the chamber of secrets. They don't really know what goes on in here. They're not really sure. And so when you tell them, oh, I think you have gingivitis or, you know, you've got this periodontal disease, it scares them to death because they don't even know what goes on in here to begin with. And how do I even begin? I need your help. So be kind, be patient, and be willing to spend a few extra minutes with them talking about what they need to do at home. Give them simple instructions, because at least they'll be able to follow those simple instructions. And every time you see them, encourage them, like, hey, you're doing better. You're doing better. You know, keep this up, because that they need you as that resource.
Amen, my brother. All right, everybody, for Medical History Mysteries, we will see you all next week.
Take care, everybody.